appreciate you, Lisa. Thank you. Alrighty, so we have a couple people, looks like, head back into their seats. I'll go ahead and talk slow so we can go ahead and get everyone back here. Alrighty, so can you believe that we are already at our final session? This day has flown by, and I hope you've all enjoyed it as much as I have. Our final session will be about the influential masterpiece. From a virtual reality startup co-founder, to a Hollywood star, to an entrepreneurial surgeon, to an angel investor, we'll be learning about their amazing accomplishments and the journeys that it took them to get there. You're going to be at the edge of your seat for this one, I can guarantee that. But I don't want to leave you waiting any longer, so let me introduce our first speaker. If you've ever used or even heard of the Oculus virtual reality headset, get pumped because you're about to hear from the co-founder and chief engineer himself, Jack McCauley. He designed and built this incredible technology before it was acquired by Facebook in 2014. So not only is he an accomplished engineer, but Jack is an inventor with numerous US patents and is a philanthropist to boot. But let's hear more about it from the man himself. Please welcome Jack McCauley.
As she pointed out, my name is, first of all, Stephanie Throne did a wonderful job. She preceded me. I was really riveted by that. Thanks, Stephanie. I don't know if you're still here, but it's going to be hard to beat that. I'm a Berkeley alumni. Cal just celebrated their 150th anniversary last year. And I participate at Berkeley. I'm a faculty member also now. The education I got in California in the 70s was when I grew up here. I got a really good education despite being a mediocre student. I'll get into that in a second. I also want to talk about, I know the audience here a little bit more on the topic about my experiences in China. I worked in China for 10 years in southern China, producing stuff I invented. I want to talk about the relationship stuff and some of the policy stuff a little bit, and not so much the education part. The education part of my slide deck is pretty negative, and I don't want to be a bummer. So, these are some of the things I worked on, I'm also a philanthropist. I've been very fortunate. One of the things that I made sure that I did in my career was staying in touch with people. And like this event, it's a smaller event, but if I say I'm going to be somewhere, I'll show up. Even if I'm sick, I'll still be there. That's very important to me. I was taught that by my father, who was in the military. It's like, if you say you're going to be somewhere, you better be there. So those kinds of things are very important. But not burning your bridges with people. If you're working at a startup or a venture and it's not working out well, and it's time for you to leave, and maybe you get let go, whatever it is, it happens. You shake their hand and say thank you for the employment, and I always kind of did that. And then I would follow up with an email if something's not working well and say how they're doing. And the other thing that I did is I always memorized people's family, especially my colleagues, their kids and stuff like that. I'd always ask them how their kids were doing, even the people in Asia. Families, different structures different there, but that always worked well for me, and they remembered me. Maybe the thing didn't work out we were working on, but next time something comes up, you'll call me, and that's always what happens. Look at those connections. I'm a faculty member at UC Berkeley. This slide is screwed up, but that's Jacobs Institute, and myself, I'm Paul Jacobs, who's the chairman of Qualcomm, built this place with other donors. But primarily me. I'm the top 25 donor at UC Berkeley. I donate my wealth to Cal and other institutions. I'm also a trustee at MSRI, which is a math institute. I'm a STEM-oriented person. I like science and technology, and I can't write very well, and I don't speak very well. I'm not very articulate, but that stuff I'm very good at. And so I just sort of lean towards that, and any organization that's associated with that. The problem in California, the problem in the United States right now, we don't produce enough engineers. The math education and the science education here is not very good. And I don't know why that, well, I know why that is, because I did a lot of research into it to find out what the problem was. And I'll talk about that in the slide, but Most of my work, the production part of the work, which is later on in my career, I was doing mass production and running the team and running the engineering team and then development team and putting people together, the right qualities of people together to produce things. And a lot of that involved working with Asian companies, manufacturers, and so forth. I have a non-profit and it's education-based, as I noted. And I'm going to talk about public education in California. The K through 12 education is ranked near the bottom, and the university system is at the opposite end of the spectrum, number four, and why that is. I'll talk about that. And I was a mediocre student. I'm from the days of Steve Jobs, those guys in my generation, and Wozniak. They're all public educated people, and neither of those guys went to college. I did, back then, you left school, and we didn't have a lot of homework to do either. I mean, I didn't do any homework. I was not a good homework guy. I was a test taker when I got to Berkeley. I always like skip class and then go take the exam. And they'd say, you're doing well, you're not turning in all your work. I said, well, I took the test, I know the material. And I think it's hard to argue with that, but my grades weren't very good. I was a daydreamer. I was always in trouble for staring out the window. I was doing doodling. So the person that introduced me noted, I'm the co-founder of Oculus VR, I was a chief engineer there. I left in 2015 because I didn't want to work at Facebook. It was fun for me. I'm an inventor. I've got a bunch of patents. I got in the habit of, I was talking to someone about this before the session here, but I was in the habit of patenting stuff because I got ripped off all the time. Like I'd do something and then someone would show up somewhere else. And that happened with the mouse, the scrolling mouse. I did that work in the 80s with the IBM mouse and modified the BIOS. And then it shows up about 10 years, it was 93 it started showing up. After that, I always patent stuff. And I've got tons of patents, but only 12 issued right now, but I probably authored 40 or something like that, and then file them on a continuation basis and let them expire or whatever. When I was at Activision working on Guitar Hero, who's familiar with Guitar Hero?
Yeah!
I was also the chief engineer on that, and the designer, not of the game, but of all the hardware, and organizing the team and working with the vendors like Microsoft and Nintendo and Sony and people like that, and trying to get the whole system together, a system-wide thing. And so I did that also. We got acquired by Activision in 2007, which is very good for me. I'm not a founder of the company. His name was Red Octane. I wasn't a founder. I just got hired again. And then they brought me in, and then when Activision acquired me, they bought all my patents. Because most of it was around gaming. I have to keep turning around, there's no monitor for them. The other thing is, back in 80, this is a thing I was mentioning about staying in touch with people. In 85, I got hired by Ellen Berlekamp with Cyclotomics, which is Kodak Research, and we built a digital sound system. And our competitor was Dolby. And basically what you do is you record the sound digitally right on the film, exposing pixels on the film. And then there was a pixel reader thing that read the pixels and then played the sound. It didn't become the standard. Dolby became the standard, but it got an Oscar. I worked for the company, so the company got an Oscar, basically, optical radiation. I got a full academic scholarship at UC Berkeley. And back in the 80s, it was a difficult to get. You had to get interviewed, they had this whole process. I think you can get grants a lot easier these days. It was difficult to get, but it was a full scholarship, including cost of living and stuff. And I was married at the time, too. So we had to live off that. It was pretty tough. I'm a faculty member at UC Berkeley, and I'm in the school mouse I mentioned. So back to working in China. I started going over there when they set up a special economic zone outside of Shenzhen with factories and so forth. And it was very restrictive and difficult to work. And when I first started working there, I'm kind of brash and a little bit difficult to work with. and I'm demanding, and then taking that sort of attitude over into China, it just doesn't work. It just didn't work. Everything I tried, I didn't get it done for some reason. And then somebody pulled me aside and said, you're being a dick to people. And I said, no, I'm not being a dick. I'm just being, because you're too American, and the people said you're like being around a cow. Because, tall, and people, back then the people in China, and I go back to China, people are my height, size, and back then though they were short, it was 20 plus years ago, and it's amazing, nutrition, everything has improved there, but now I'm not so tall, I'm also shrunk a little bit, but, so I had to change my strategy and tactic and how to deal with a different culture, and he says you need to be smaller in size, and be polite and kind, and so I took that and with me, and it worked. I just got some mentoring and coaching on how to deal with people. In the States, that it plays well here too. But Americans are kind of like a little bit on the aggressive side, I think. And being an American, I think that taking that kind of stuff over there just didn't play well very well. But later on, I learned how to deal with people better over there, paid off. My relationships over there are very good. I made sure that I knew the owner of the factory, and made friends with him. And I got invited to weddings and banquets and all this stuff. And next time I came in with something that wasn't a big profit center for them, they'll take it because they're my friend. And with Oculus, and I can talk about that a little bit. That was the case. We had a Kickstarter campaign, and four guys, and two, one of them in their 30s, the rest of them in their 20s, the other guy's 19, and I'm like a lot older than those guys. When you take hardware into China to produce, we took it to Foxconn and these other places, they just showed us the door, they're not interested in. But I had this relationship, long-term relationship, because they'd taken Guitar Hero stuff into this factory. And I had to bundle it with another product. We took it in there, and they took it on, and they built it for us. Without that relationship that I really worked on very hard, so it's a woman. She owns a factory over there. There's no way Oculus would have ever found anyone to produce it. It's such a strange thing. She looked at me, pulled me aside, and she goes, why are you even working with these guys? I said, this is a bizarre product. But I thought it was really cool. Another thing about the relationships, I got introduced to the CEO of Oculus by a colleague at Activision, who I worked in the IP department too, who remembered me and hooked Brendan up with me. And that's because I worked on the relationship with those guys too. I just like stayed in touch with them. So it's a good lesson. So yeah, I wasn't a class guy, I was more of a tinkerer and stuff, and I got a scholarship as 9 years old, and then that's the first full room experience VR headset on the right. That actually wasn't built by us, it was built by Valve Software in Seattle, Oculus rather, and that's a scrolling mouse. I still have that thing, it doesn't work, but I'm actually good at my job too. I'm a technical guy. Like I said, I'm not a writer. I don't write well, and I don't like to read much. But I can do the work. That's an important thing. If you're going to do a startup and you want to produce a product, you have to know some of the technology about it. It's really hard to judge how long something takes. A programmer will tell you, oh, that'll take me 6 weeks. Well, 6 months later, he's still working on it. You got to be able to know what the truth is. And so I recommend people to. Either get a trustworthy technical person or get sort of technically oriented yourself when you're in a startup. Okay, I got 5 minutes left, so I'm going to bomb on education. And it's really, really, one of the things that really bothers me is what happened to the education system, the K-12. The university system's good. I mean, it's in really good shape. I think Massachusetts number one. For both public K-12 and the university system, but we're number four for university, and it's pulled by UCLA, Stanford, the big names. A lot of the state, San Jose State's a great school too. Like I said, I grew up in the 70s in the education system. I would say that I was by the time I graduated, I pretty much knew all the lower division stuff at Berkeley. So I've had pretty much breezed through until I hit my upper division. I was pretty arrogant. I said I took 20 units in engineering in junior year, and I did not do well. That was a mistake. I always remember that. It's like, don't overload yourself. I passed all my classes, but I never did that again. Next time I took 12 units, and I learned. So the big problem, you know, you've heard of Prop 13. Prop 13 came about in 78, and that switched the funding allocation from the local level to the state level. So the state could now use the funds that come in from property taxes to pay for public education. And it also did some other stuff that wasn't so good for education. But basically now the state's in charge. This is in 78 of funding allocation for the university and K-12. So that's not why the system, it impacted the system. That means that local school boards could no longer allocate money to schools. They were the ones who know what money is required. The state now does it. So there was like this inversion of the funds that came in. Incidentally, your property taxes you pay, one of the limits was placed on Prop 13 was that if you purchased a house in 78, you pay 78 taxes, 1978, if you live there forever. Well, those properties get turned over every 5 or 10 years. No one lives in a house. Well, some people do. In San Francisco, people live a long time, but in the suburbs, people moving in and out and stuff. So every time you move out, the property gets reassessed, and then property money flows in. So really, money isn't the big problem in California. I mean, it is, but it's because it's controlled by the state. The problem with the education system in California is the certification that system was done. This is according to RAND Corporation, who did a lot of research on this. I didn't get anything out of U.S. News and World Report. I got it from RAND. And so what happened was they changed the certification. So an intern could now be a math teacher, didn't even know that they didn't know the subject. And there's some demographic things that occurred too. And if you look at the state and you look at the best schools, they're always in areas where with high income. And that's because parents are educated and it's important. So as I mentioned, we're 44 out of 50. It's really, really bad. And there's nothing that I can do about that. But I can, with my resources, try to help the university system, and they're more than eager to take it, believe me. So we were 4 out of 50 for higher education. So what I do now is donate money, give away money to education, and I'm starting to look at the K-12 stuff and the STEM-related stuff. I just don't know how to manage that right now, but that's where I'm looking. Incidentally, if you look at the people who are supported by like free lunches and stuff like that. There's a school in Lodi, which is out in the valley, that is number one for it's not K-12, it's 6 through 8th grade. It's a middle school. They have the highest test scores, but their demographics are different, and they also get a lot of public assistance, the students do. So I mean, I don't buy this argument that somehow because they're different or whatever, that they can't learn. These kids are learning, and it's an unusual case. So improve access to quality educators, and more charter schools and better choices for people who live in areas that aren't as wealthy. It would help. This is the thing, this train that they're building, that we had a bond measure, $60 billion to build a train from Sacramento. And they should just dump that project. That's my opinion, put it in education. I just don't understand why it's something that taxpayers wanted at one time. I'm not sure that it's worked out very well, but this is my hobby. I'm just going to race through these real fast. I built this car. I have a R&D facility and in the East Bay, and I build stuff there, and this is a car I built. I finished that in 2010. That's a sports car, and that's me. I was probably hungover that day. And that's a current car I'm building. This is another race car. And that's an overhead shot of it sitting on the ground. The back is open there, and there's the wheels and stuff. We make everything there. Wheels, even we make the wheels there. I have a machine and all that stuff and the staff. And that's my lab there. And you can see some wheels sitting down on the ground. And I have all this 3D printers and all that stuff, about that. And a lot of that stuff is the same stuff that did Jacobs. And if I need something made, I get to take it to Jacobs Institute of Berkeley and make it there. They have a great water jet cutting machine and stuff. I like make parts there. And this is a video of my, this is a tracking device. This is a laser drawing that lizardry pattern there, and this is my son, and it caught that ping pong ball.
Yeah.
Let's go back and watch it again. So this is that white thing there is a laser. It's, there's a little tiny MEMS mirror in there that catches the ball. I built this for a VR room experience and I abandoned it. That market for VR is pretty soft. It hasn't turned out the way that people predicted. It's just one of those things that new technologies come up, and then like cell phones, and then everyone buys them, and they kind of like stay there for a while, then something new comes up. I think that's what the case with this stuff. Okay, so thank you very much.
All right, Jack, thank you so much for sharing about your education philosophy. His accomplishments, super inspiring, right? I agree. So, next up, Maristella Evangelista. She pursued a typical model minority career path by becoming a surgeon. Yet, one should realize that every life, including her own, is a creative and unique journey and is not meant to be lived out in a cookie-cutter way. She began a path of self-discovery and realized that the sky is the limit when it comes to fulfilling your dreams and your passions. Please welcome Maristella Evangelista.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for being here, and thank you to the Imagine Talks for having me. This is actually the first time I get to share this story in this way, and I am super excited. Oh, you know I don't have the slide thing. So I'm gonna have that one. Okay, well we'll keep going for now. So, I'm gonna tell you about my winning formula. At least when I was 4 years old, it was, give them what they want and you'll be golden. Can you advance 2 slides? There I am. Okay, picture me on my first airplane ride, stomping my feet on the chair in front of me, saying, Mom, Mom, Mom. And she turns to me and she says, you be quiet. And the look on her face, it was like horrifying for me. I didn't even know that I had messed up. And then I look at the guy in front of her, in front of me, and I realize, oh, he's really angry. So I learned very quickly to be independent and not to speak up unless I really needed to. And that was my way of giving them what I wanted, what they wanted. So I got into grade school, right? And what it looked like was making my friends happy. Give them what they want, and you'll be golden. I learned how to make friends. I realized that being smart was not very cool. And so I stopped reading. I used to read all the time. I stopped reading. I stopped doing my homework, unless I really needed to. I knew that my parents wanted straight A's, but I learned that A minus was actually enough for them. So I got just that, 90%. That's what I aimed for every time. And I did the bare minimum just to get there. And on the other side, I learned to like boys. I learned how to dress like they did with my Doc Martens, my knee highs in my uniform skirt, and boxers underneath, of course. And I got older and we started doing things like tagging the hallways with permanent marker. And experimenting with drugs, tobacco, alcohol, building bonfires in the back. And I still maintain my A minuses for my parents, of course. And I also did things like work on the yearbook, do rhythmic gymnastics, dance, 3 varsity sports. I went to college and my winning formula was still working. It looked like me going out with my friends until 2 in the morning, and then going to the bar, or then going to the library to write the 10-page paper that was due the next day. And that even got me into medical school. You know, somehow I got into medical school. And in medical school, it turns out it's all pass-fail. And it's all multiple choice, too. Okay? So I learned that I could study half of the material, study for half of the tests, and I would still pass. And I was still doing things like being the editor of the school newsletter, and working on the American Medical Association. And I got my master's in business administration at the same time. And I worked as a bartender. Okay? So this was me walking the fine line between being smart enough, but also being cool. That got me into one of the most prestigious specialties in medicine, plastic surgery. And not only that, I got into a program in the alluring Southern California. And I got there by giving them what they want, and you will be golden. You know, surgeons spend hours in the operating room, right? Hours in the hospital. They probably spend more time in the hospital than they do at home, right? So I figured out if I could be someone who was upbeat, hardworking, give them what they want, someone that was always a pleasure to work with, then I would be golden, and I was. Oh, that's college. That's cool. And that is where I did my training, in Southern California. But here, in my residency, is where I started realizing my winning formula was breaking down. I am 28 years old at this point, and it's my first day on the plastic surgery service, and I'm washing my hands at the sink, I'm looking into the operating room, and I'm nervous. Because I'm about to do a case with someone I've never worked with, and it's plastic surgery, never done this case, I've never worked with this guy, okay, do what you know to do, just, you've done this before, right? So I walk into the operating room, I take the drapes from the nurse, I start draping the patient. My boss walks in, who taught you how to drape? I'm speechless, okay, I just looked at him. And then I spent the rest of the day just doing my best to mimic his every move. He picked up the instrument, I picked up the instrument. He did one side, I did the other. I tried my hardest to just give him what he wanted, right? Well, at the end of the day, he said, "Didn't you win that Resident of the Year award last year?" I said, "Yes, I did. I just don't see it." And there it was. For me, it was like, oh, I was not gonna fool him, okay? I had been found out, and everyone was about to find out that I really didn't deserve to be here, that I was actually mediocre. And I spent the next 2 years figuring out how to be okay with just being mediocre. And I put this slide up because this was our conference room. Every week we had conference here. I would sit, I don't think this is a pointer, but I would sit in that top right corner, the third seat in, the one that's kind of close to the bookcase, because I knew that was just out of sight of the person who was sitting over here. They weren't going to ask me as many questions. I would avoid getting asked questions because I didn't want them to know that I didn't know the answer. I didn't ask questions because I didn't want them to know I didn't know the answer. You see, I could be okay being mediocre, but I didn't want them to know that I was a complete failure. I would hate getting compared to other residents. And I just spent so much time strategizing my way to graduation. Okay, so now I'm 30 years old, I'm 9 months from graduating, and someone tells me, about this course called the Landmark Forum. Now, this is a weekend course. It's for personal and professional development. It changed my life, one of my patients told me, actually. So this is why I went. I went to an event. And I signed up, mostly out of curiosity, but what I saw there was people who had this air of confidence, like they changed jobs or made huge leaps in the middle of their life, without fear or doubt. And I didn't really know what I would get, but I just thought, you know, I probably could use a little bit of that. But what I got in that one weekend was that I got that I had built my whole life around making everyone else happy. That I gauged my success on whether or not people liked me. That I actually gave up my voice because I was so busy pleasing everyone else. I didn't have an opinion about anything. I liked everything. Okay, and this is how I made decisions back then. It was ask enough people, get consensus, and then do the thing that upset the least amount of people or that the most amount of people agreed with, right? When I went back to work after this weekend, what I felt was a physical lightness. Because by figuring out that I could be okay with everything I was and everything that I wasn't, that I didn't need to strategize my whole day, and I didn't need to think about whether or not I measured up, I actually had so much more freedom, aliveness, happiness, and peace of mind. I asked the questions that I wanted to ask. I learned things that I wanted to learn, and I enjoyed my residency. And what happened in that 9 months was, by the time I graduated, I had the most spectacular celebration. My whole family was there, and not only that, my parents' 10 closest friends were there. My 10 closest friends were there. And I got accolades. One of my bosses was crying because he was so proud. The other boss, the one who said I didn't deserve the award, he actually said I sure showed him. I got a constant stream of job opportunities after that. People offered me interviews at places that people never heard back from. I got the most highly coveted jobs. These are my mentors that I still keep in touch with. I met my husband, Travis, and we got engaged in just 6 months of knowing each other. I got to become a stepmom to Aiden and move across the country to California, and then move back to Michigan less than a year later. But this didn't all become rose, you know, it wasn't all, whatever the saying is, it wasn't all great. All right? This was a struggle too. There were people in my life who were not okay with the way I was, who weren't comfortable with the decisions I made, who outright disagreed, disinvited me from events, ignored my calls or texts, mocked and ridiculed me for what I was doing. And that was hard. Because if you remember, my golden rule was, you know, give them what they want and you'll be golden. And I also based my success on whether or not people liked me. So I struggled. And it was hard for me. Like, why didn't they understand? Why didn't they get it? But I will never regret finding myself and doing things that were true to myself, because I knew that that was me. And I would never trade that amount of freedom and happiness for that struggle. And so, I'd like to close with my 3 points. You are perfect, just the way you are. Everything that you are and everything that you're not is all you and something to be proud of, not something to be ashamed of or hide or fear. Don't try to fit the mold. On top of that, you are anything, anything you want and more. Don't put a cap on what's possible and just dare to dream big. And finally, and most importantly, find your true self, because therein you can unlock your true power and happiness. Thank you.
It is so wonderful how Maristella was able to truly find herself and what to find her, and left us with some really good tips too. So we are at our final talk. You may recognize the two folks that you're about to meet. First, Ernestine Fu. She graced the cover of Forbes magazine in 2011 at age 19 after selling her first startup. She was also still in college at the time, so she was doing two jobs at once. Not only that, but we are so lucky to have her again with us this year as one of our speakers during our Lash and Legend talks. Today, she will be interviewing James Leo, the famous martial arts actor who has made 80 film and television appearances, knows 5 types of martial arts, and trained Brad Pitt for the movie Troy. I could go on, but I think you'd rather see it for yourself.
This is an award I recently got. Actually, no, it's James's. James, you want to come out?
Yeah.
Play the video.
Standing stunt coordination for a drama series, limited series, or movie.
The Emmy goes to Marvel's Luke Cage!
Oh,
wait, wait.
time to join us today. To be honest, I'm a little bit intimidated being on stage with you, since when I was a kid, I had two things that I wanted to be growing up. First one was a magician, and second one was like a stunt actor. Basically the same thing, more or less. And obviously you've done the latter. So I guess I'm curious in terms of, how did you get into stunt acting in the first place? What really inspired you?
First, thank you for staying. You know, it's been a long day for you guys, and I really appreciate that. When I first started, because I came from a martial art background, and they had a big cattle call for the original Kung Fu series, and me and my buddy said, hey, let's go check that out. Stood in line, might have been 100 people in line, so we said, oh, we had nothing to do anyway. So we got in, and they chose about 10 or 12 people out of that. So we ended up doing all the flashback scenes in the Shaolin Temple. It was Shaolin Temple in Burbank, California, but as a Kung Fu practitioner, it was like this cool dream. They put us in the skull cap, and we did all the stuff with the disciples doing martial arts in the background, and we're in every episode for the opening, so it was fantastic. Made some money.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Does someone have the clicker? Oh, see? That was it. Just snap it.
Oh. Oh, there it is.
Jump back. Snap backwards. Okay. So, James, what is going on here? What is this? These aren't on my Facebook wall, you know? I don't have photos
that
of
one?
This.
Snooki, that was on my own call. It was Halloween. I decided this bright idea that didn't have anything else. So I said, that's when Jersey Shore was popular. And I said, I'm going to go be Snooki. And that was a little wiggish. But complete respect for the ladies that were dressed, because the party was outside. And it was just freezing. And couldn't find high heels to fit my big feet, so luckily I didn't have to do that. The middle one, I'm very proud of, but talking about selling out, it was a national commercial for Hewlett-Packard. And the joke was ordering uniforms for the school, but it was bad technology, so kid coming back all these different outfits. So we had wardrobe came to me with, I don't know if you've ever seen it, the tights are about this big when it's, and they said, we have to get you in it. I have pretty big thighs. It took two wardrobe people just squeezing this thing onto me. But we had fun, we had some laughs. That was from a horror movie.
Oh, yeah, it would be terrifying if I like woke up and saw that. So, okay, let's look. These photos are more of your day-to-day life photos.
Yeah, this is my job. I get to go to work and basically pretend for a living. So I'm very blessed. That's the Kung Fu with Dave Carradine. And down below is an amazing movie, Inception. I was in that room. It was another scene. I'm in the room with just Ken Watanabe, Leonardo, those other two people. So just me and the director. This is my first time I've ever done anything like this, so it's different from being on the set. But part of that too, I want to get the message across that I want to push myself to constantly do things that out of my comfort zone, and this is not in my comfort zone, but it's all about trying it and just go ahead and do things.
So what was it like when you first started in Hollywood, being an Asian American stunt actor? Like, what was it really like starting out?
I I like to call it as there's challenges starting when I did. I first started, I wanted to be this action actor because growing up, all I saw was, you know, on TV were Three Stooges, cowboys, and at that time I just didn't think like one day I want to do that until Bruce Lee came around, and that's the game changer. Finally, I said, whoa, I could kind of look like someone like that. Not quite, he's just ripped. So that got me on the path, like, maybe I can be an action actor. But I went, got an agent, found out that all the auditions, the parts were the computer nerd, Asian guy, the scientist. You get in there and they say, oh yeah, that was great, but can you do it with an accent? And it was not fun doing that. And then eventually, the Asian bad guys kind of came into being. So that at least a little bit more of kind of a fun. You get to be a bad guy, get beat up. And I have to say, I've been kind of beat up by everybody in Hollywood from I work with, just throwing names, Jackie Chan, Jet Li. Oh, yeah, all these guys. Charlie Sheen's fantastic work with. On the far left, that was the first time I had to shave my head on Tropic Thunder. And we got on the set, and a group of stunt guys are there, and Ben Stiller points me out of all these guys and told the stunt coordinator, I want his head shaved. And it was like, what? Why me?
But you had to do it. And then you liked the look, so you kept
it. Well, and he said, you know, pretty much if you don't, you're probably going home soon. If you do, you're going to be here for the run of the show. And this was in beautiful Kauai, where it was just like paradise. So I said, fine, I said, yeah, all right, shave it. But the funny thing is, after a couple of days, I loved it. It was like understanding how to be a monk, and you have this freedom of kind of like all your worldly things are gone. And every day is a bad hair day. It doesn't matter.
You don't need shampoo.
Yes. Yeah. So now, last year, I got cast to do a little part on this new series called Warrior. It's a concept Bruce Lee came up with. And they wanted me to play a Sifu, a teacher of that. It was a flashback scene. And they said, we need you to shave your head. And I said, that's, yeah. I'm kind of waiting for an excuse. So I'm kind of keeping that now. I'm going to be, try to be the wise master. And then it was a great time with Get Smart with Anne Hathaway, and also with Steve Carell.
Not important actor.
Yeah. Nicest actors. Comedy was so fun working with these people.
So, I guess, can you tell us a funny story working with one of these actors? Like, what are they actually like working with? You know, we see them on the big screen, but
yeah,
I want to hear some juicy stories.
Charlie Sheen's one of my favorite people I've worked with. I got to play with him on Hot Shots Part Judah, and it was me in a little cloth thing. He was also wearing this little thing, but he got just yoked out for this thing. I think he had a little help. But the nicest, most straight guy, hardworking, not what you hear about on the news. We had a great time working. After that, maybe 6 months after, I was walking along Beverly Hills. He happened to be down the street. I hear, hey, I'll take you on right here. Like Charlie Sheen was there. So just wonderful guy. Can't say enough about him.
That's awesome. So this past year, Crazy Rich Asians made a huge splash in Hollywood for being one of the first films in Hollywood, to be on the big screen, to be in theaters, to have an all Asian American cast,
right.
all Asian cast, and then previously Joy Luck Club also made a huge splash with that. And wanted to just get your thoughts in terms of how has Hollywood really changed in terms of bringing Asians, bringing Asian Americans into the community?
I am so proud and happy for Crazy Rich Asians. It's to me fine. I was born in Escalon, California, which is kind of...
Oh, you were going to say you were born in Singapore.
Oh,
no. That's one of the crazy rich Asians.
Actually, I'm crazy rich. but my parents moved me down before I was 1 year old, down to South Central LA, where I grew up. So being an Asian American, I finally saw a movie that portrayed Asian Americans and blending... going to Asia and having that culture clash and how each side learns something from each other. It's a gift for us. It's finally opened the opportunities and I can see, she's a trooper. Her voice is gone, she's still
My voice isn't usually this nasty. I'm not acting.
I don't, tell her it's sexy.
Good job.
So it's a very important breakthrough for opportunities now for Asian Americans. And again, we find that there's finally the male lead is a positive guy. We were talking backstage. My little thing about Joy Luck Club, great movie. The one male good guy in that movie was Andrew McCarthy. All the Asian males were not the nice guys, so to me it didn't quite balance it. But here's all Asian cast, and the great thing is the audience here took to it because it was just perfect. A good movie first, a love story. And enough people related to it because it's a great love story that the numbers just blew out there. And as much as difficult as Hollywood is, they are basically a business machine. So they will now look at that and think that, well, we can make money on this kind of a movie. So it opens the door for more projects that Asian Americans can be in. The best thing we can do as an Asian American community is to go support movies like this. I went first day, 3 days later I took my wife to go, because she couldn't make it the first day, just to make sure we get the numbers on the box office. Just do your little part. If everybody helps like that,
yeah,
it makes a difference.
Especially for opening weekend and
yeah.
the weekend after.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah, I think it's really changed in terms of, like you mentioned, like when you were first starting out, people want you to be the nerdy Asian, like that stereotype of
yeah.
an Asian, and then Crazy Rich Asians has really
yeah.
changed that because it's not the smartest kid in school, not the nerdy Asian, not the
yeah.
bad villain, but this like heartthrob couple that everyone aspires to
right.
be. And, like crazy rich and like lavish and
yeah.
whatnot. So, do you think we're going to continue to see more films like this, especially with Crazy Rich Asians, or like what do you think we're going to see with Hollywood films?
Well, the author wrote three books. There's a trilogy.
So there's two more.
There are greenlit number two, but hopefully we're looking at other things. So, probably the great news: Marvel has also put into development Masters of Kung Fu. So it's. Hopefully they cast an Asian guy to play Shang-Chi, but at least half Asian. We'll give them that. I see the little light coming through the door now.
Yeah. What about Asians represented on TV as opposed to movies? Some of those fresh off the boat, being one example.
Yeah.
Or do we still have a long way to go?
Yeah, TV, it's still, there's still some need for a positive person, an Asian American. I watched the trailer for that way back, and just the male with the accent and it's like, I'm not interested in watching it. But I should.
So what are your future plans? Like, you've got this fancy award that
and
looks like...
This is, I have to say, this is
it's really heavy
absolutely
to hear,
amazing.
By the way.
And I look at this, too. Look at it as an opportunity. I'm representing American Asians. And what's great about it, I am the first American Asian or Asian stunt coordinator to win an Emmy for stunt coordination. It is really about not anymore knocking on the door like a nice, polite Asian who need to kick down doors. It's how powerful the Afro-American community came. They demanded to have things. Whenever you see a production, they have a lot of the crew or Afro-American, the cast, and everything is across the board. Out of curiosity, I just went on IMDb, looked up Fresh Off the Boat, to see what the crew was. I didn't see any Asians. So I wish they would help support it that way. Not only is it important in front of the camera, but also behind the camera. And that's how we start creating more opportunities to get more people, they have more experience, they get better. Hopefully we get into the producing side so we can actually control. And writing is important. So any of you writers out there, please come up with things. And this is the perfect time of day. Perfect time for us now.
Yeah. So off stage, what do you do in your free time besides kicking down doors or, yeah.
Well, and that's part of what's great too. I want to encourage everybody. I'm so blessed because what I do, I love. It is already my passion. So when I go to work, and I don't tell my wife this, but I am actually going to go play. It's not at work. I'm there creating action, creating, you know, just magic. And I'm not working at all. I'm just having a good time. So find that passion. Find either it's martial arts, find movies. Go from what your heart tells you. And that's, I mean, it's you hear it all the time. But you know, life is short. And it really is. It's amazing how fast did last year go for everybody. Bam.
Yes.
Take 5 of those, 10 of those, suddenly, like, what the heck? So, go for it. Because I can really tell you, I went on my own, I wrote, produced, directed, starred, did catering, did everything on one little movie. And it was the toughest thing I've ever done, but I kept telling myself, you know what, at least I don't want to be on my deathbed and just say that, God, I should have done it. I should have tried. It's much better that you got screwed up and it's like, well, maybe I shouldn't have done that. It's a much better way to feel. So run your life like that. There's no regrets because actually you win by just trying.
So we're going to wrap up today with, I just want one volunteer, aspiring actor or actress, to come on stage.
You're going to do a fight scene with us.
We're going to see James train one person for 30 seconds.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Okay, so... I want to know, like, a lot of these actors and actresses, like, they don't know anything about stunt. What's the very first thing that you teach them?
Safety first, because especially if you work with stunt guys, and even actors need to know, if you're doing a fight scene with Tom Cruise, do not hit Tom Cruise. You'll be, get out of here. So, and part of the choreography And that's kind of, also, I'm always trying to relate it to life. We start very slow. I call it Tai Chi speed. And so if I'm going to throw a punch, we walk through it, so I'm just throwing it at this speed. So we do that, and the philosophy is slow is smooth. Smooth is fast. Fast is power. So you progress like this, and kind of take that to kind of everything you do. So you take it in steps. So now he's going to block.
Our volunteer looks a little terrified, by the way.
Oh, what's that?
Our volunteer looks a little intimidated by you, just a little. I'm like standing, I'm sitting very far away from this.
Oh, no. Yeah. All right, so as this punch is coming here, I want you just to step to the side a little bit. It's called getting off the railroad track. So you don't want to stand there and just take the punch. So you're going to move a little bit. But same time, you're going to come put your hand here. It's like saying hello on a telephone or your cell phone. So bring your cell phone up to your right ear. Nice. Perfect. So now, so I'm coming slow-mo, so you're going to step to your left block. Wow! Nice. So now fast, no. Got it. So you start building from that point on. So you be punch, be a kick, and things like that. So why don't you throw, let's just start with a simple front kick. So you're going to pretend you're going to come for my face. Good thing I'm not this tall. Okay. So do you have martial art background? That's so stereotype.
I also play violin.
Okay, perfect. So play and kick. No. So form is very important in filming something because we can always speed things up with the film or post-production. But, and part of what actors, if they're just standing like this, there's nothing we can correct. So that's important. So, and come, and it's kind of telegraphing. So the, with the right leg back, so just a front kick. So it's chamber, out, back, and down. So keep it clean like that. So slow first. So right here, out, and back. Yeah, it's great. So if you can do it slow, it's easier to do it fast. Okay, so first I'm going to do this slow. Punch, block. I come back. He's going to kick at me. So I'm going to step to the side and come back. Cool.
This looks like straight out of a movie. Let's give a round of applause for our volunteer and
so if you guys are interested in doing things like that, everybody has a phone. Get your buddies together, shoot it, edit, post it on YouTube. You never know. It could go viral and you're the guy we're looking for. And girls, women, ladies.
Thank you again.
Oh, one thing. To help me feel a little more comfortable, to feel like this is a, what you call like a dojo or koan, if everybody can stand up, you want to stretch your legs anyway. This is how we do a sign of respect. It would be the fist, it would be right fist. This hand covers the fist. That's coming in respect and a bow. And always keep your eyes on your palm. And then I want everybody to give me a warrior cry, like, yeah, one, two, three. Get a selfie?
I knew it.
Oh no, I'm not good with selfies.
Francis is good at selfies. Francis is the selfie master.
Yeah. Why don't you just do a photo? I have photos assigned for free. Don't charge me. Here we go. Oh, we have to.
Your stance.
Yeah, come here.
Everybody stand up.
Thank you.
Not every day that you get to hear the mind of a Hollywood martial arts actor, but that was really cool. Thank you, James and Ernestine, for interviewing with us today. And with that, Imagine Talks 2019 is officially coming to an end. I'm sad too. We've learned so much about how change truly does start with you. I want to thank all of you for coming and being here with us today, and of course for our viewers online for our live stream as well. For allowing me to be your guide today and also for your support in attending. And I want to thank our speakers for allowing us to be able to take a peek into their lives so that we too can learn how to be motivated and empowered, overcome cultural diversity challenges, get on the road to self-healing, and become the next creator of an influential masterpiece. Now, we couldn't have done this all without the support of our sponsors, so I would like to give a big thank you to E The Look by Apple for sponsoring makeup for our sponsors, our speakers, excuse me, Jamie Image for being our makeup sponsor, Zoe for being a sponsor, and our legacy sponsors, Monster Cable, Sugar Bowl Bakery, and Forever Beaumont. I'd like to call up Crystal Lee, our event director, who helped make all of the logistics of this conference come to life.
Yay, Crystal!
Thank you all for coming. I think this is one of our like best turnouts in all the years of Imagine Talks. And I want to first thank my wonderful team, like all my staffs, all the volunteers. We worked, you know, year-round planning for this, and then when it comes to it, I'm pretty sure half of us have not slept for like over 24 hours. So I thank you guys so much for helping out and creating Imagine Talks. I also want to thank our venue sponsor, the Oakland Asian Cultural Center. This is an amazing space. It's super beautiful, as you guys can see. And if anyone is interested to rent out the auditorium or any of the rooms here, you guys can definitely do so. And check out their programs. They have amazing programs here, definitely to help the Chinese community. To help the Asian community, promoting different cultures and history and heritage. And I would like to introduce Rose on stage. Oh, Gloria, you want to speak? Anything? You want to say anything, Gloria?
Oh, I'd just like to thank everyone for coming. It's been really inspirational, and I hope we can do this again.
Thank you so much, Gloria. All right, guys, let's pull out your raffle tickets because we're going to have Rose come on stage. We're going to do the raffles. Oh, and get flowers this year. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Crystal. Oh, and now we want to present a certificate to Melanie for being our wonderful MC today. Her first time MCing, and I hope that you'll be able to do more. Okay, so we are going to go ahead and do our raffle drawing now. Let me just go ahead and bring the basket and the prizes over. So thank you very much. And I'm going to ask Eileen Bui to come out because she came all the way from, where did you come from to come to the Imagine Talks? She's our second princess for the Miss Asian Global Pageant. And if you want to know more about her, in depth about her, she's in a podcast with Kim Chi Chow. Would you like to say something?
Thank you. It was 2018 was a year that I done a lot of things, first time in my life, including the pageant, the Miss Asian Global. And it was my pleasure to be in the podcast of Kim Chi Chow. It's the first podcast in the US for Asian audience around the world. So I'm very honored to do that and to be part of MAG, and hopefully to involve more community building activities and to bring out more events like this. My pleasure.
Yes. You can stick around and help with the raffle. Just ask Kimberly Tom to help with the raffle. But I also want to acknowledge Vanessa, who's been handling the slideshow. So she actually flew in from Boston. She attends MIT, and she thought that this event was worthwhile to come. But I gotta tell you her background. She got accepted to MIT, and she asked her teacher if she could participate in our pageant, and her teacher said it wouldn't allow her to come participate in our pageant. She had to make a choice. She was studying all night and participating in our pageant, and I'm so glad that she got the title of Miss Asian Scholastic, and she flew back to help us today. She's back here. Give a pause to Vanessa. She's a graduate of UC Berkeley as well, and she's also very talented. So let's bring out the basket for the raffle drawing. Great. The first prize that we are going to give, okay, if you don't come up to get the prize, then we are just going to have it on the side here. The first prize that we have is the from Forever Bowmore is the Pure Turmeric Cream and Cleanser for Blemish and Scar Remedy. Well, we're so many young people here, you certainly still have blemish. So, go ahead and pull it and call the number.
Number is 373367. 373367. Are you here?
Okay, please pass the number to Chrisley. She's. Mm-hmm. Yeah, give it to Chrisley. Okay, it doesn't. You got the number though, right? You wrote it down? Okay, next one is sun visor for the car from KT Sunstock. And
okay, 483626.
Make the ticket up.
Okay, I repeat again, this number 483626. 626 in the end. Yeah?
So, Kimberly, you could get her the sun visor for the car from K2 Sunstock. And we also have another one too, so. And the next one is a sunshade for your car. And it's two pack and also from KT Sunstock.
And the number is 483947. I repeat, 483947.
And we have another one too, so who else wins this sunshade for your car?
The number is 484124. 484124.
Okay, next winner is they received Dancing Leaves Tea and Teapot set from Numi. They also donated the tea that we enjoyed this morning.
483-620.
Next one, we have another Dancing Leaves tea and teapot set.
Okay, and the number is 483-737.
483-737.
I win!
Come on up, congratulations. Numi is the best tea. Oh wow, next is two tickets to the 2019 Miss Asian Global Pageant to be held on August 10th at the Herbst Theater. Not only do you get tickets to the pageant, we also have our wonderful launch party and press event. So that's a total of six tickets for three events.
And congratulations to the number 6466752. 6466752.
Great, and next we have Kaylon San Francisco gift certificate for $50 courtesy of Katie Lamb, who just launched her business. And you saw our many of our ladies today modeling the glamorous attire. Well, if you're interested in those attires, go to that table over there. Congratulations to Katie Lamb. And who get, and there's two certificates.
483-633.
Okay, and our second certificate. Oh, Sophia will enjoy that.
The second certificate goes to number 2900197. 2900197.
Great, okay, we have three more items. It is the Clarity HD wireless headphones from Monster.
Congratulations number
493948. 493948. Oh, Sunny, all right. I sold them those tickets. Okay, next is the Monster Firecracker Photo Light Bluetooth Speaker.
Congratulations number 483640.
Oh, Kimchi Chow. Well, how did that happen? That Kimchi interviews Eileen on the podcast, and thank you for your support. I think she's the first Asian podcaster, so accolades to her. Okay, and the top prize is the Samsung 24-inch smart LED TV donated by Vince Aguilar.
Congratulations number 483693. 483693.
Grand prize winner, oh my god! Sarah, congratulations, front row, was so attentive, you deserve the grand prize. Like all of you too, thank you so much for your support, and we look forward to seeing you at our launch party. Did you guys all have a great time? Thank you very much, we look forward to seeing you soon. We have a reception, we have food, and just connect with one another, and we appreciate your support.